discussion on that theme or on that sub-theme. But before we get there, we have quite eminent guests with us. We have people from the Responsible Gambling Foundation. We also have a representative of the Department of Trade, Industry and Competition who will give us a brief overview from a legislative and policy point of view of what our position is currently and what we are looking at in the near future from a gambling regulation point of view. So without further ado, I would like to start the webinar and open our program by handing you over to our Chief Operations Officer, Ms. Poppy Kweyama from the National Gambling Board. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and our distinguished guests. COVID-19 pandemic has already significantly impacted in the business and will have a potential lasting impact in the economy. Many industries in South Africa have been badly hit, including the gambling industry, which has been heavily impacted by the pandemic. Land-based casinos and other gambling establishments saw a massive losses following closure when the national lockdown came into effect on the 27th of March in 2020. According to various reports, land-based casinos have the largest gambling market share in South Africa, but they have steadily been losing market share to online casinos. This shift has been accelerated by COVID-19. Research reveals that while the traditional gambling industry is facing unparalleled losses, online gambling sites have reported a surge in activity since the national lockdown came into effect. Many punters reverted to online gambling since they could not access land-based casinos as a result of the lockdown, thus becoming home-based punters. The social distancing restrictions that are in place under level one could be the deterring factor for punters to return to land-based casinos. Hence, there are emerging trends in the gambling industry where people choose to gamble at home rather than to frequent a gambling outlet because of the convenience it provides and how to physically distance themselves as per government regulations. For all businesses, what they will find that is COVID-19 has changed many consumers' attitudes, behaviors, and beliefs. If they are not reaching them online, where many of them are spending the majority of their time, they will soon find themselves obsolete. There has been a persistent move towards online commerce and digitization in many sectors, while pre-COVID-19 consumers have increasingly living their lives online. The pandemic has already been credited with accelerating this online migration to even greater degree as consumers are forced to socially distance themselves. While COVID-19 has resulted in both temporary and permanent trends across many sectors, shift towards online seem to be here to stay. Online gambling remains illegal in the country, but that has not deterred punters to engage in this illegal activity. It is thus important for the gambling industry as a whole to innovate and leverage on the opportunities brought about disruptors like COVID-19 to ensure their survival and adaptability. It is clear that the logic that applied yesterday in the gambling industry cannot continue as it has become obsolete and irrelevant. The new normal requires a paradigm shift where technology will be embraced and used to the advance of all involved in the industry. What is new normal, we ask? The answer to this question lies within our ability and capability to innovate and take the real lead in the gambling industry to keep abreast with what other sectors of the economy are doing, still remaining within the confines of the law. Online gambling should not be the only topic discussed when technology subject is brought about in the gambling industry. there are so many other transformative technologies to be explored and employed in the gambling sector. With this theme will broadly cover a series of subtopics falling within the broader theme and ranging from social aspects of gambling, looking into the shift in punter behavior and gambling mode preference, to more technical aspects of how the industry has responded to the impact of the gambling industry and is innovating in certification of gambling offerings. This will further extend to an exploration of how punters and industry in South Africa are engaging with technology in newer ways, thus facilitating growth in the industry. A series of webinars are envisaged to be held under this theme to embrace a new normal, which should be logical in the gambling South Africa. I invite you as our distinguished guests to enjoy today's discussion and hope to see you in our future series of webinars. With these few words, I would like to thank you.
Thank you, Poppy. That was very informative, and I think it clearly sets the tone for what our discussion will be for the broader theme of the transformative technology in, from a regulatory perspective, and then coming down to what we are going to discuss specifically today in our first webinar. I would like to now hand over to Mr. Nkwatsi Mashimaete, who is the Director of Gambling Gambling Law and Policy at the Department of Trade, Industry and Competition.
Good morning, everyone. Yeah, as indicated, my name is Nkwatsi Mashimaete. I work at the Department of Trade and Industry. Yeah, and thanks again for having me today. Yes, I think my mind is just to outline the policy perspective, and I would, as always, just indicate that the policy primacy in the country remain attached to the principles that the Viehan Commission actually guided us to. And the main principle that I will be talking about, which I believe is of relevance here today, is that we need to be balancing the social aspects of the regulation with the economic growth of the business in South Africa. So we need to look at the issues of how society is affected socially, and also try to encourage that the business also grow at the same time. Why do we do this? It's because with gambling, we have the hidden harms that comes with it, and those harms can pose harm to society, and we need to be playing guard to that. I think my colleagues from the South African Responsible Gambling Foundation will attest, as they are embarking on their campaign currently for November, dealing with responsible gambling issues, targeting those people who will be using their bonuses for December. This is an aspect that we cannot ignore. And as technologies evolve, we do appreciate that there are things that we can immediately incorporate in our regulatory space, but there are some that will actually need our time and collaborative minds to actually try to work on it, ensuring that we do not actually rush things that might end up undermining our underlying principles that has informed the regulation of gambling in the country. And as a result of the recommendations that I've indicated from the Viehan Commission, that we must actually have a stricter approach when we regulate gambling to ensure that we are not only making money, but we also prevent the harms effect. We have actually chosen that we will regulate casinos, we will regulate bingo and limited payout machines and betting, which betting was actually the dominant gambling mode that was allowed in the country post 1994, prior to 1994, sorry. And we actually made this conscious choice because we do not want to proliferate and overstimulate the demand to gambling. We do not want every corner of our country to be representing gambling in the country. We must ensure that it is in designated spaces and it is limited as much as we can. Hence, we have 41 casino licenses and a limit of 50,000 limited payout machines, and also strictly regulating regulated license rollouts for other modes of gambling to ensure that while we are making money, we don't just allow it to overspread all over the country. And we need to maintain that stricter balance between maximizing the revenue and the social harms that gambling comes with. We should also learn from the 2005 introduction of the electronic bingo terminals in the country. It actually came as a shock. We still remain with the marks of it even today, because we have not completely resolved this issue about the rollout of EBTs. We will remember that we only had the traditional form of bingo, which we were not too much worried about because we were not actually seeing the potential to overstimulate and proliferate gambling only if that mode was offered. But with the introduction of EBTs, we actually saw a bigger challenge because this came with slot machines and we did not even have a policy that guided how many machines we need in the country, how we should actually allow it alongside the traditional form of bingo. And the delays in the National Gambling Amendment Bill that is in Parliament also makes this challenge even bigger because we still cannot control it. And as a result, it creates disharmony between us and the provinces who are actually interested on rolling them out. And as a result, we have no maximum control on it. What I'm actually trying to say is when we want to debate the issue of introducing online gambling, we should try to be calm. Try to work together in finding a workable solution. We cannot do it now because of the pandemic. I think we need to allow ourselves time to work on exactly what form do we need and how do we want to roll it out in the country. And I think you will remember that in 2008, the interactive gambling legislation was passed, but it has not been proclaimed for implementation. And one of the main reasons is we were actually not totally in agreement, although this should have happened as early as 2006, according to the directive in the National Gambling Act of 2004, because it was supposed to be introduced 2 years after the 2004 Act was passed. But we were still not in agreement, because some who may remember when we went to Parliament in 2009, when the new administration was introduced then, the new members of parliament were actually shocked that we have allowed online gambling. I understand the changes, that they might have changed their attitude by now. But at the moment, this has actually been the reason why this legislation has not come into effect. And the department also has adopted a stance again, which still entrenches the provision in the National Gambling Act that only gambling that is authorized should be allowed. And that actually means because online gambling is not authorized at the moment, it is not allowed and it is therefore illegal to offer online gambling in the country. And I think the only time that it will be allowed is when we have a comprehensive policy that will introduce that. And we cannot try to rush it now. I really think so. Thank you.
Thank you, Nkwatsi. I think that's very informative, and it's also a bit sobering for us to remember that while we sometimes get excited by the prospects of change. Change can't happen overnight, and we always have to be cautious in how we introduce it. I think at this stage, we are going to move toward the panel. Before I do that, I've just noticed, by the way, for those who are either watching it or streaming it through YouTube or have registered through the Zoom channel on which we are right now, that there is a function for you to put comments or questions, and we'll be picking those up and trying to have them discussed if there are questions to the panel. I see we have one comment from Mr. Tyrone Dobbin, who has said on behalf of Sporting Bet as well as the WBA, that they thank us for these webinars and welcoming the opportunity to collaboratively contribute to these conversations. And I thank you, Aaron Dobbin, for that. I think it captures exactly the spirit in which we are hosting these events. For those of you who may have participated before, you'll remember that last year the NGB had a conference, and we made a promise and a commitment from then that for all these types of discussions, we are in this together as an industry, and we need to always have conversations collaboratively and have a chance for everyone to participate, whether it is from the policy-making side, from the department, as Mr. Mashimaiti represented us just now, and its regulators, its operators, its manufacturers, its our test labs, everyone in the value chain are players and have a say. So I thank you for that comment. I will now hand you over to our panel. We have colleagues from the National Gambling Board, and we have two colleagues from the South African Responsible Gambling Foundation. They will introduce themselves during that, when they introduce the panel. And that discussion will be moderated by Mr. I'm just losing my signal here. That it will be moderated by Mr. Alpheus Matsubula from Root Monitoring Systems. And I hope you find the discussion quite interesting and enjoyable. Thank you.
Thank you, Program Director Brian. Thank you to the speaker, Mr. Mashamaite, for laying the groundwork. The session that we are going to start now is actually the theme that this webinar is all about. And I believe the program director has already laid the ground in terms of why it's happening. And all the participants, I would like to welcome you all and start by thanking the National Gambling Board, obviously, for organizing this webinar and putting the technology aspect with these trying times, and also thanking the Proudly South Africa for putting this platform together. As the program director has already explained, actually this specific program is streamed live on Facebook. For those who don't have access to Zoom, who have registered to participate, they can actually tell their colleagues to actually go to www.facebook.com/proudlysa. And the tag that they need to look for is called Local Friday with Rob Byrne. And the thank you so much. Yep. So let's go ahead and continue with our topic today, which is called Transformation Technology from the Regulatory Perspective. The webinar is seeking to address the following question, which is called Yesterday Logic versus the New Normal. As all the participants and the panelists, we are all aware that the COVID-19 pandemic has actually brought a very unusual situation all over the world. As we all know that the gambling industry is mostly classified as a entertainment business, and therefore the pandemic actually has brought a challenge to us. Just to set a bit of house rules, our panelists, you will be given a predefined time in which you need to obviously deal with specific agenda points that you need to talk to in terms of the topic. And then those who are participating in this specific webinar, they will be given an opportunity to obviously write their questions on the platform itself. As you are busy writing your questions, those pop up on our screen, and then we can be able to allocate time accordingly. So questions will only be dealt with at the end. At this particular point in time, I would like to introduce my panelists. The panelists are as follows. We've got Ms. Bawinile Ngobo, who's the Acting Chief Compliance Officer at the National Gambling Board. We've got Mr. Shelton Pajiwa, who is a Senior Manager at the Gaming Technology at the National Gambling Board. We've got Mr. Witness Sarumbe, who is the Finance Manager at the South African Responsible Gambling. And we've got Mr. Mashudu Nechivungulu, who is a Senior Treatment Advisor at the South African Responsible Gambling Foundation. I would like to take this moment to actually allow each and every panelist to just briefly introduce themselves. They will have 2 minutes each. I will start with Ms. Bawinile Ngobo, just to briefly introduce herself to the forum. Thank you.
Thank you, Alfie. Bawinile Ngobo is commonly known in the industry as Winnie, having been in the gambling industry for over 20 years, interacted with quite a number of industry role players, from gaming labs to operators. Currently, Bawinile is Acting Chief Compliance, involved in the gambling legislation compliance evaluations of PLAs, as well as focusing on enforcement of gambling legislation, in particular, the illegal gambling. Thank you.
Thank you, Bawinile. You were within the allowable time. We'll go to the next panelist, Mr. Shelton Pajiwa. The digital floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Matsebula. My name is Shelton Pajiwa. I'm a senior manager, gaming technology at NGB. My role mostly is advisory and also to the head of the institution, and also in terms of compliance of the gambling industry, review of the technologies that are being introduced into the industry. I've been in the industry since 2008, starting at a test lab, and I joined the National Gambling Board. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pajiwa, for obeying the rules and be within the allowable time. The next panelist is Mr. Witness Sarumbe. Mr. Sarumbe, the floor is yours.
Good day to our viewers across the world. Thank you for attending this webinar. My name is Witness Sarumbe. I'm from the Responsible Gambling Foundation. I'm the finance manager there. I've joined the gambling industry. I have about 1.5 years now. And yes, when you need something to help as the foundation, we are there. We are mainly there to assist people who are struggling with gambling. Thank you.
I think we can go to the next. The next person is Mashuru from the foundation.
Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Mashudu Nechibungururu. I am the senior treatment advisor at the South African Responsible Gambling Foundation, and where my responsibilities are to advise treatment professionals on how to assist people who are struggling with gambling disorder, and also get involved in research regarding gambling addiction in South Africa. Thank you for having me in this webinar.
Thank you, Mashudu. Unfortunately, it looks like we've lost the witness. We hope technology will be on our side and we can be able to come back and so that we can continue with the full list of panelists. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to just briefly thank all the participants and the attendees whom we can see. And then somebody has actually posed a question on the question line. I'm just dealing with this question because it's related to how people can actually be able to access the live streaming on the social media. The first one is www.facebook.com/proudlysa. When you look there, you will find the live streaming under the tag called Local Friday with Rob Byrne. You can also do the same thing on YouTube. You go to YouTube and search for Proudly SA, and then you will be able to see the live streaming on that platform. And I've been informed that we also have Twitter, and the Twitter can be accessed via twitter.com/proudlysa. You will be able to see the live streaming there. Without wasting any time, I would like to go straight and begin to address the question of what we are trying to address with this webinar. And the main question that has been asked, as I said in the beginning, is to say, does yesterday logic, when it's compared to the new normal, how can we actually deal with it as the gambling industry in South Africa? And I would like to acknowledge, while I'm on it, together with the list of attendees, I can see a lot of stakeholders which are actually represented here. I can see the LPM industry. I can see the bookmaking fraternity in terms of bookmakers represented on the attendee list. I can see manufacturers. I can see casino operators. And then to those other stakeholders which I have not covered, I will definitely cover you and engage you through the question and answer session. Just to repeat again, don't hesitate really to put your questions on the platform, because as they are coming in, we'll deal with them, but we'll only deal with questions and answers once we are done with the program as it's been prepared. Without wasting any time, I would like to start with the first question to my panelists, and that goes to Ms. Bawini Lengobo. The question to you, Winnie, is as follows. Now, when we look at the COVID-19, and the challenges that it has brought to us. Can you please take us through what are we referring to when we are saying yesterday logic versus the normal? To you, Mr. Bawinile, Ms. Bawinile.
Thank you for allowing me to respond on that topic, a very interesting one, of course. Yesterday's logic versus the new normal. Gambling in South Africa is based on a destination approach, is most commonly known as a destination approach kind of an environment. That means that the model requires that punters has to travel physically to gambling destinations such as casinos, bingo halls, etc. Due to the national lockdown since March 2020, South Africans have been home-based, meaning that for a number of months, lockdown since March, South Africans has been doing all their activities online, be it retail shopping, takeout and groceries. Movie releases were streamed online. Now, you can imagine even schooling was done remotely online. Now, with the easing of the restrictions of the lockdown, business has to reopen, but there's still social distancing conditions that are still imposed. Now, as the risk of infection persists, now the question is, will punters, having been accustomed to being home-based consumers, will they be willing to revert back to the old normal and return to traditional gambling establishments? Or will they prefer to seek alternative gambling offerings from the comfort of their own homes? If the answer is the latter, how are the regulators operators, as well as manufacturers, all the industry role players, equipping themselves to deal with this new paradigm? This is now the conversation that we would like to have. Remember that gambling in South Africa is commonly, as I said earlier, is commonly known to be a destination approach. Now, the shift to the online gambling activities, will they still be willing to go back to the traditional methods of gambling? There are investments already made on a traditional method of gambling. We can name a few big casinos that all of us are familiar with, the bingo operations that are already up and running. What's going to happen to those? These are the considerations that we need to be engaging on as the industry role players. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bawinile. That was very refreshing and guiding us in terms of what is it that we are really trying to address and deal with this specific topic and under these trying times, which all of us, I'm sure, when this pandemic was first announced in late 2019 from China, we all thought it was something that will never hit our shores. But on that particular note, it is what it is. We are where we are. All we can do is to obviously look for alternative and creative ways to continue with life. As all of us, we are aware that we are actually social beings. We like to interact. We like to talk to people face to face. The digital phenomena is actually still a challenge to us. And I know for the fact that the so-called AMA 2000, they are embracing this fully, but at the same time, they are losing the very basic makeup of our DNA as human beings that we always want to interact with others. On that special note, I would like now to pose the following question to our next panelist, Mr. Pajiwa Shelton, and the question that is directed to you, sir, is as follows: to say, now that the industry has to adapt, can you please tell us how do you believe the industry needs to adapt, and then how opportunities for existing licenses can actually be adapted to offer same service by changing the delivery model to an online using transformative technologies. Over to you, Mr. Pajua.
Thank you, Elfias. At this point in time, the law in South Africa doesn't allow online gambling. So our industry at this point cannot adapt our services or products to being offered online. So our casinos can't offer their services online at this point in time. But that, when you look at that as well, when we say the new normal, it's not just that people are shopping online. Gambling is not a normal, or you can't look at it in terms of the way we look at the other day-to-day activities. In South Africa, gambling is a destination approach, and it's considered entertainment. And when we say entertainment, generally, when you want to be entertained, you want to socialize. So the technology can be used for our industries to still pursue the destination approach, right? It's how we then adapt the technologies that we have in our casinos so that we accommodate for our approach. But we brought in by, say, pandemic or any other changes that the communities have. You will find that because we can't go online at this point in time until the law has changed, we can only look at how our industry can leverage technology and make the gambling more entertaining, or have more entertaining facilities that attract punters to come in. So that's the way we can only use technology. We should not look at technology in terms of online gambling only. That's just one aspect of how technology can be used in the industry. So that's my take in terms of that. So then, the other aspect that we have to also take note of or cognizance of is that gambling is a regulated environment. Because it's regulated, whatever our operators do has to be within the confines of their license conditions and the law. So it's how they can adopt technology. Because when you look at all the technologies that are available in the world today, they are not made for gambling, right? But gambling adapts and adopts the technologies so that they fit within the confines and definition of the business, and also in terms of the legislation of that jurisdiction. So at this point in time, it would be premature to look at technology in terms of using it for online gambling in South Africa. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pajiwa. Premature
to look at technology in terms of using it for online gambling in South Africa. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pajiwa, for that great insight. In terms of what we currently have and where we are and how we would like to explore and take advantage of what technology is actually giving us. You have touched on a number of things which somehow a lot of our attendees and participants will realize that in most cases, the gambling sector tends to be very slow when it comes to embracing technology and dealing with the latest innovation in technology. And as Mr. Pajiwa has already explained, that the gambling industry is one of the highly regulated environment. So you will realize that, yes, technology sometimes it actually break boundaries. It is for the very same reason that you can see when the COVID-19 actually hit our shores, everybody did not know how to deal with the environment, because one of the basic thing that the pandemic has brought into our shores is that people cannot interact So on that specific note, I know that a lot of our industry players, whether it be a manufacturer or be an operator, they are all trying to find ways within the existing legislative framework to still offer the product, which is entertainment. And a lot of us, we used to want to make sure that we always go to the shop and touch and feel the groceries that we buy. But during our level five lockdown, we began to have smarter ways of actually dealing with you through the online shopping, and you just buy once, all you do, you just keep on adding going forward. But obviously there are a lot of challenges which comes with technology, because the first thing that comes into everybody's mind is, can I trust it? And at the same time, there are many risks that comes with that, which obviously has to be dealt with. And I'm sure from the responsible gambling point of view, whenever you are talking about giving punters more or giving the consumers more in terms of flexibility and having to consume whatever product that is actually being offered, they always worry is about the risk. What are the risks? So on the point of dealing with the risk, I will pose the following question to Witness. I hope Witness is back with us. I think Witness is back with us because we lost her a little, we lost him earlier on. So Witness, the question that is directed to you, it goes as follows. All this technology aspect of gambling, as we are busy trying to find innovative ways and the means to still actually offer the very same content and with the very same opportunities that we are busy talking about, there is definitely risks that are associated to that. Now, from a perspective of responsible gambling, can you please tell us what will you say those risks are, and also expand on what the effect will be when customers can actually consume this service while they're at home? Over to you, Witness.
Thank you, moderator. For those who had lost me earlier, I'm Witness Sarombe from Responsible Gambling Foundation. I hope you can all hear me and see the video now. Okay. I think one of the reasons why the gambling industry is heavily regulated is because of responsible gambling. At the end of the day, the country needs to have responsible people, and it is for the same reason that it being entertainment needs to be regulated, and people need to indulge with responsibility at the end. Now, having online gambling, which is the new normal and which has been accessed to people at the moment, it poses a number of risks to the pandas. One of the first thing, it is very easy to access. We are in the fourth industrial revolution where people have got smartphones wherever they are. So it's a matter of you sitting at home on your phone, on your laptop, on your tablet, and you access it. You don't need to go to the casino. You don't need to go to the physical shop to place a bet. So it having easy of access, it brings a lot of challenges. Now it is easy for underaged people to gamble. As you are aware, the Gambling Act here only allows people who are 18 years or older to participate in gambling. And we have got children who are less than 18 years who have got access to these smartphones, to these smart devices. And they become susceptible to this as well, that they can place bets and no one is able to monitor it if it is online gambling. The other thing, it is also has an influence that when people are under the influence, let's say of drugs, when you go to a normal casino and they notice that you are under the influence of drugs, you are not allowed to get into the casino. But because now you've got your phone, the moment you go, you are not allowed into the casino, you can sit, literally sit by the doorstep and place your bet. And this all drives us away from the concept of being a responsible person or responsible people. So it poses those challenges. The other thing is, it becomes difficult for pandas to control themselves. Before the fourth industrial revolution, or before the online gambling was introduced, people had to go physically walk, physically drive to a betting place to place a bet. But because they're sitting at home, they can do it anytime. It drives a huge desire for people to bet, and it becomes difficult for people to control themselves. At the end, it poses a high risk for addictive gambling. I think at the end of the day, we are going to have more people being addicted to gambling at the end. And one of the other challenges which are brought by online gambling is there's a huge risk of criminal activity taking place. There's a huge risk of criminal activity taking place. People will be loading money using their credit cards. So there's a huge risk that scammers will take advantage of that, and people will be losing their money. The other thing, the payouts, who knows whether they are being fair or not? It's also a gap which needs to be answered when this is being discussed between in the parliament. The other thing which also open is you don't really know who you are dealing with. In a casino, you know who you are dealing with. When you go to a betting shop, you know who you are dealing with. But when you're online, you are just assuming to be that you are dealing with someone, but you can't really verify that. So it opens up for criminal activity to take place. And also, when you're betting online and you're betting using your card, you're not losing cash. You know, when you go to a casino, some people withdraw money and put it in their pockets as a budget of what they need to bet on. But when you're betting online, you're just transferring money from your card to your account, which is online, and you're not losing that physical cash. Some people don't feel that pain. And at the end, are we having responsible people? People who end up being broke, people who end up getting into debt because of easy of it, how easy it is to just transfer money from your account, from your bank account to your gambling account. So these are some of the risks which are brought by online gambling, which we really need to think about when this is regulated. Thank you, and I'll take you back to the moderator.
Thank you, witness. That was a very interesting view coming from the responsible gambling part. Like as you said, the most important thing is that under the regulated gambling, there should always be that responsible element that needs to come to the picture. So now, I am sure most of our attendees, I can see questions flogging in, some very interesting, and then some very mind-triggering. It is expected that this topic obviously is going to activate a lot of debate, and I strongly believe that was the intention of this webinar, to say as the industry, let us talk. But while we are talking, we've got different players within this entertainment business of ours. Like as I said earlier, to say we've got regulators whose their job is to ensure that everything is done according to the legislative requirements. And then we've got manufacturers who are actually building and producing all this technology that we are enjoying. And then we've got the operators who make sure that actually the very same product that is being produced by the operator is actually lent to the destination, which is the consumer. But on that very same note, the COVID-19 pandemic has actually brought in a lot of very interesting situations. Amongst those, we have seen obviously most of the land-based entertainment areas being closed during the hard lockdown, And then we have seen a lot of sporting events actually being closed. But that does not necessarily mean or it didn't mean that the offering stopped during that particular point in time. So on that very same note, I will now ask you, Mashudu, to please just give us your view in the following question, which I'm posing to you. And the question goes like, after now listening to all the panelists and the topic that is before us, from the foundation point of view, that is the Responsible Gambling Foundation, what have you as a foundation observed during the hard lockdown? Obviously, the license operators were closed, and then we still had some gambling facilities which were open, mostly those which are online. For example, the sports betting online. But we know for the fact that the very same sports that the consumers or the punters will normally bet against, they were also closed. So can you just briefly take us through what you as the foundation has observed during the hard lockdown era? Thank you.
Thank you, moderator. Once again, my name is Mashudu. I'm a treatment advisor. Our responsibilities at the South African Responsible Gambling Foundation is to treat those who are suffering from gambling disorder. What we've noticed during the COVID-19 lockdown is there was a decline in number of people who are presenting with gambling disorder. We didn't receive many people who were struggling with gambling disorder. People who used to gamble in the casinos never presented with gambling disorder during the lockdown period. But a majority of people or people that we've treated who were presenting with gambling disorder during the period of lockdown were the people who are saying that they are struggling with online gambling. And then when we started to observe the patterns of online gambling and the patterns of gambling in a casino, as witness was saying, we noticed that online gambling is more addictive compared to the people who are gambling at the casino. And as we know that the lockdown had came with different kinds of challenges in our society, some people lost their jobs, they were unemployed. And the majority of people who gamble with the idea of trying to make money, these are the people who develop a gambling disorder. So many people were pushed to go to gamble with the intention of trying to put bread on top of the table. And then they were gambling illegally, most of them, because some members of our society cannot really access the online gambling, specifically when we talk of the old age people. So they revert to illegal gambling. We also noticed lots of people who have self-excluded themselves from the casino, who wanted to go back to the casino. We came across lots of people who were craving to go back to the casino, who were very not comfortable with the idea that, or the reality that they cannot access gambling. And what I've noticed is majority of the people we treated, they were doing online gambling, and some of them, they were doing illegal gambling. Thank you, Margarita.
Thank you, Mashudu, for the insight. It is indeed a very interesting topic as far as I'm concerned, because it's actually suggesting that we need to be innovative. And how do we bring about innovation? In most cases, innovation comes in a situation of crisis. I strongly believe the pandemic is a crisis situation. That's why our administration decided to actually declare the state of national disaster, because it was a disaster. But then under the very same environment, I am sure a lot of the industry stakeholders, they've been thinking about smarter ways, better ways to actually begin to be innovative in trying to still reach the very same customer who might be remotely placed, And then I'm convinced that a lot of manufacturers, they have been bringing up a new product to deal with your typical social distancing, making sure that the equipment, whenever it's been touched, there is a proper information that is provided to say now is actually time to begin to clean that specific slot machine in anticipating that the next customer is gonna come and touch it. And all those, they've been very, 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 very important measures, and also the innovative ways to begin to deal with those. And then some of the industry players, typically manufacturers who actually give us all this technology, they've been looking at alternative ways to actually provide some of the solution that goes with that. But there is one thing that still remains: illegal gambling. Like as Mashudu has stated, it has been happening. So now on that particular note, there is a question that is actually for Ms. Bawinile in regards to the very same issue, because I know a lot of questions they are related to there today to say, what are we doing to deal with the illegal gambling, et cetera, which is a common question that comes from anybody within the gambling sector, wanting to know how do we deal with that. But now, Bawinile, this is for you. You are dealing with the enforcement and dealing with illegal gambling mostly. During the hard lockdown, I am sure you were not able to travel because you, unless you were classified as essential service. So now, given that environment, can you please talk to us about the illegal gambling? From an enforcement point of view, what are your concerns regarding illegal gambling from the technology point of view? What has been your observation, and how do you see illegal gambling adapting to home base using transformative technology? So in other words, is that we know that the world in which we live in enforcement is slowly changing with technology coming into the picture. Bawinile, over to you.
Thank you once again, Alfie. There's quite a number of things that are disturbing when it comes to illegal gambling activities, in particular the move to online gambling. One, as one think, as regulators, the legislators has put in place legislation to control gambling in South Africa. There are strict controls that are in place for land-based gambling in South Africa. For every licensee to operate, they have to ensure that they comply to maintain their licenses. Now, as regulators, we're looking at issues of under online gambling. There are many areas that are of concern. When people are engaging on these activities through mobile connections, there are issues of FIC compliance. Financial Intelligence Center has imposed certain requirements for licensed establishments. It is important that they know their customer. Now the question is online gambling, when they gamble remotely, what measures are in place to ensure that we know for sure that a person gambling is not an excluded person, one, is not a minor, two. Note that a profile can be created. Once the profile has been created, anyone who has access to that profile can gamble. Now, gambling legislation prohibits actually minors, people under 18, to gamble. Two, people who has established that they have a gambling problem are not allowed in the licensed gambling environment. Now, with the move to the activities that are taking place online, it is quite disturbing to note that this space is so not regulated that such social issues may cause very bad impact on society. Now, illegal gambling has in the past been more on land-based gambling activities, which included slots machines usually found in spaza shops. Now, even kids could play such games. Those are in control now with the assistance of other law enforcement agencies. We have managed to collaborate with them to get these activities underway. Now, we have internet-based gambling, which is offered by internet casinos. People during lockdown were able to register their profile and go home and gamble. My question as a regulator is, what assurance do I have? One, that the game that is being offered, if it is, for instance, a roulette game online, what assurance do I have that that wheel is serviced? What assurance do I have that that dealer will not rob the person gambling online? So these are all the concerns that we should be looking at. All of these activities which are conducted within the licensed gambling establishments in South Africa are regulated, strictly regulated. So for protection of our communities, people engaging in gambling. Operators in the country, they know that they have to comply with all these requirements because regular inspections will be conducted. Now the big question is, when people participate in the unregulated space, who's there to protect them? Who's there to ensure that when there are disputes arising from payments, who is there to protect them? None of the regulators have mandate in that space. All we can do is report the matter to the police for them to prosecute the operator. Moreover, the winnings that people will be, the winnings that are due to the people who are engaging in these activities. Some are lucky they reach them, but not all of them do get their money because in terms of our legislation, those monies has to be reported to the NGB for application of a court order to forfeit them to the state. So we have been investigating a number of those during lockdown, and people were complaining that they did not know online gambling is illegal. Now, this is why we are engaging on these aspects, just to get people to understand that there is no protection in these activities. If you are excluded in the gambling, in a licensed space because you have a gambling problem, you need to undergo the necessary, you need to take the necessary steps to treat your condition and make sure that when you gamble responsibly. Now, we have issues of people gambling remotely with no controls at all. I thank you.
Thank you, Bawinile. It is indeed very tricky, and I guess a lot of attendees they are waiting with
people gambling remotely with no controls at all. I thank you.
Thank you. So, yeah, I assume a lot of attendees who are watching this live, and they've got a lot of questions that they would like to put forward to us. I hope I will do justice in some of your questions which I've collated. And the main question under this topic, it is actually around online and interactive. Mr. Pajiwa, this question is directed to you. Can you please, as a technologist, explain to us whether interactive gambling is it legal in South Africa? That's the first question. The second question is, during lockdown, even now, we have seen a number of adverts on television which are actually offering casino tiles themed contingencies. Are those legal? And should punters actually participate on such? Over to you, Mr. Pajua.
Thank you, Elfias. To the first question, interactive gambling is not illegal in South Africa, and it's defined by Section 11 of the National Gambling Act. So by virtue of that, it becomes illegal. So interactive gambling is not legal. That's the first thing that we have to address. Then the next question that you asked in terms of the offerings that are there in terms of casino type games being offered by bookmakers, that is an area of great concern because when you look at the product, it's how you look at the product being presented to a punter, right? Bookmakers are allowed by law to take bets on contingencies, right? So you are looking at a situation where there's a sport on Saturday, and South Africa is playing Burkina Faso, and a punter places bets based on the odds or fixed odds that are there. So you can do that even online, right? Because all you are doing is submitting a bet. Then you look at, if you now look at the model that we have with certain products like your casino games being offered online by bookmakers, like your where you have live dealers, you participating in the activity, interacting with the casino employee, that then skirts, or for us, we feel that it's a bit on the ambiguous side, and it's difficult for me to come out right and say it's illegal, because we have colleagues who have reviewed these submissions in terms of licensing in the provinces. So they have reviewed these products, and in their wisdom, they have allowed the products. So for us as National Gambling Board, we feel that there's an area of concern, maybe an area of stricter controls in terms of regulating the products and how they are being presented to the punter. The other thing that you have raised is in terms of advertising, right? The products, the way they are being advertised, they give the impression that it's interactive gambling in terms of the NGA in the National Gambling Act. So it's a very, very difficult call to make outright to say it's illegal or it's legal at this point. We are in the process of reviewing these products and in discussion with our colleagues in the provinces. So I'm not sure if I've really answered your question, Elfias, with regards to this aspect.
Thank you, Mr. Pajiwa. I'm definitely going to stay with you for a moment because this topic is actually talking to people like you and me, people who are dealing with technology. So now, you have already explained what interactive gambling is for us, and then what does it mean to the punter at home, and then what does it mean to the industry in terms of who can do what and so forth. So now, as a follow-up question, Mr. Pajiwa, and this is obviously collated as part of the questions which are we are seeing them on our question and answer board. The question is loaded with multiple things that we need to deal with and cover.
Okay.
The question goes as follows, to say, we are talking about the technology now. What does it actually mean to the regulator? That's the first thing that you need to tell us, because we know and we have realized that actually the way in which regulators do things has changed drastically. Follow up to that, these technologies, are they transforming our gambling industry? Number one, what does it mean to the regulators? Number two, are they transforming our industry? How can then this very same transformation in terms of technology, talking about YR, how is it going to model the way in which we are actually doing things as regulators? Because COVID definitely has taught us a number of scenarios that we never anticipated. Final one, have the new normal actually ushered the transformation in this technology? I'm sure this is a very loaded question, Mr. Pajiwa. Over to you.
I'll give it my best shot. I think let's go step by step, right? The first thing that we have to recognize is that as regulators, we don't regulate technology. We regulate the activity of gambling. That's the first thing that we have to be very clear about when we look at the impact of technology in the industry. The regulator is not there to regulate technology. We are there to regulate the activity of gambling. That's the first thing that we have to be clear about. So now your next question was, has technology really transformed the industry? Is that your next question, Elfias?
That is very correct. Given the situation that our industry is always catching up with the current technology, given the legislative requirements.
Yeah. Now, that's also a very loaded question in terms of how we should look at it. But yes, as I had said earlier on, our industry, the technologies that come into the world are not targeted at gambling. It's gambling that adapts and adopts those technologies to improve the way they present their products to the punter. So yes, technology has transformed the way the punter looks at the product. If you go into a casino today, and if you compare with a few years back, where you had, when you were calling the machines one armed bandits and something like that, where you had maybe just three lines. You go into a casino today, you find machines where you can actually participate like you are inside the game itself. You are not just pressing a button. So technology has transformed the industry, the products that are being offered by the industry. But in all that, the regulator has focused on regulating the gambling activity, because technology changes all the time. And you can't stop the progress that technology comes with. There's no one who can stop that. As I have said, the technology will be around you. It's someone adapting it to a specific business where now we are using it in terms of gambling, right? So yes, technology has actually transformed the industry, and it is exciting the way it has been transformed. I know my colleagues from responsible gambling would not be very excited about that. But gambling is entertainment. It should be looked at in that light. So manufacturers will always make products that excite punters, that entertain punters, and operators will always procure such products because they are also in the business of entertainment. And the business of entertainment demands, it doesn't stand still. But as regulators then, we then have to step in where we feel, or in terms of the law, where technology is now being used to circumvent the law. But you can't stop technology, and technology is transforming the industry. And it's transforming the industry in a lot of ways. Operators will tell you this, even in terms of how they monitor their own pandas, how they advertise to particular pandas, how they understand their pandas. I think the act of number crunching, right? Just looking at the data that they collect and how they use technology, how they advertise, sift through that data and make business sense out of it. So we should not just look at technology as the evil in terms of which angle we are looking at, but we are talking of the industry here. So technology is not bad for the industry, right? It's how we then use it, where we use it in a way where we cross the line from being responsible operators or people in the industry, because everyone is chasing a profit and everyone is trying to excite their panda as well. So yes, I would say technology has actually transformed the industry. What was the next question, Elfias?
It seems we have actually gone through my loaded questions in a very systematic and broader way. And then I thank you for that, Mr. Pajiwa. Thank you very much for those answers. Now we will actually go to deal with the question and answer, specifically looking at the questions which are showing on the board. We've got a lot of questions here, attendees. Please forgive me if I happen not to touch your all questions, because some of the questions are actually loaded, and then some obviously will probably be answered accordingly on this live by appropriate people. But on that note, I will take the first question first. The first question is coming from Stella. And the question reads as follows. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for this engagement. Other regulators started in 2017 already to consider technology in its regulatory service. For instance, the Financial Sector Conduct Authority, FSCA, has made financial technology, fintech, a strategic focus. What dialogue are we having as regulators, manufacturers, operators, and policymakers to ensure that we are proactive in regulating online? Gambling, other than saying online gambling is illegal, it is illegal, yes, but our own consumers and corporates are participating in this form of gambling. All of us here are running behind the consumer and corporate regulations in terms of technology. What do we need to change? Very interesting question. Why are we not changing? Why are we not running ahead of technology curve? Why lags in this area? Whilst the economic focus is heading towards online technology, our markets are there. They are working on big data. What are we doing about this? My panelist, this is a loaded question. Who would like to take it? Mr. Bajiwa, I'll go with you first.
All right, thank you, Elfias. This question is in two parts. The part of the policy in terms of why we are not going for online gaming, I'll leave it to the responsible authority, that's Mr. Nkwatse from the DTI. What I can answer in terms of why we are lagging behind the technology curve, and an example has been given in terms of the financial services. I don't think, and I haven't seen anywhere where the regulator is ahead of the technological curve, or anyone for that matter. The only person who is ahead of the technological curve is the one who is doing research at university and developing those technologies. So by saying that, it's very difficult to have a to regulate based on technology. The operator's responsibility is to his shareholders. The government's responsibility is to the citizenry of the country. So you have competing interests here. The government has to also protect the community from overstimulation. If you look at the preamble of the National Gambling Act, so that's where we are. Before anything is changed or implemented, there's a process that is followed. So in terms of allowing online gambling, there will be a process that will be followed. And I think it has been followed. And I think the discussion is still ongoing. I'm not really going to answer that part. But the technology part, as I have said, as regulators, we are regulating the gambling activity. When you look at it, a roulette game that you play in a casino is the same roulette game you can play online. It's the mode of presenting it to the punter that has to be dealt with at policy level. So it's not like the regulators are scared of technology. We are also not scared of technology. We actually understand the importance of moving with the changes in the industry. But our primary focus is to regulate the gambling aspect. Then the technological aspect, but if you talk in terms of online gambling as a mode of gambling, then that has to be dealt with at police level, for which I will leave that question to Mr. Mashamaiti. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Panjiwa. It is a very interesting topic we are dealing with today. And I think all of us who are watching and listening to this live streaming, it needs to be taken into consideration the fact that the pillars of governance consist of number of stakeholders. And those stakeholders are as follows. You've got Panta, who's sitting at home, who is a stakeholder. You've got an operator who's making sure that the industry continues, a stakeholder. You've got regulators who are administrative stakeholders. And you've got policymakers. Now, policy is always the role of a specific government institution. I know I've seen a lot of questions in the list that is being shown on screen. I am trying to cover in general some of the questions which are related and asking about policy. policy is a very a tricky part because there are laws in the country that needs to be followed before any policy change can be affected. And there is participation from all the different stakeholders, including the public as a whole. So now, the reason why I am addressing this is that I would like Mr. Mashamaite to actually just give a brief. I know in the beginning he already explained to say where we are in terms of the policy framework, legislation around this. We all know the status of the current internet or interactive casino gambling and so forth. I would like us to appreciate that processes have to be according to law. I am not posing this question to Mr. Mashamaite for no any other reason. I am posing it back to him to say, on the policy front, Mr. Mashamaite, maybe if you can just remind all the attendees and the people who are seeing this recording in terms of what is the current government position and where we are going, so that it can be very clear to everyone and it will assist us in addressing most of the policy related questions for those who didn't catch your opening statement right at the beginning.
Good day again, colleagues. I thought I can call you friends, and I think colleague is the safest one. The issue of online gambling, we all know that it was also emphasized in the current bill that we have drafted, which is currently with the select committee. And the position is that online gambling remains illegal in the country. And I think there are just a number of factors that we might need to consider going forward. And some of them is we must be very careful that when technology evolves, doesn't actually erode the benefits that we have derived from the brick and mortar type of gambling. And I think these were the concerns that even parliamentarians raised at the time when they dealt with the regulations of the interactive gambling, as indicated earlier in my opening. The issue of the fact is land-based gambling has actually created a lot of jobs that we have, and a lot of depending jobs as well, like restaurants that are in casinos and hotels attached to those. Once we actually have a situation that might lead to migration from land-based to online completely, those land-based might end up closing. We have been told during lockdown that carousel is closed. And any restaurant that may have been operating at the carousel, and Naledi Casino in Bloemfontein, I think, they can no longer operate in the absence of casino gambling. And as a result, we are talking about job losses and others. And you will also remember that the National Development Plan says when we develop policies, we must always have regard to employment that is already created and must ensure that policies actually support job growth as opposed to working opposite to that. And that's why we are cautious. And I think working together with the industry, we might actually find a better way on how this can actually be regulated properly to ensure that there won't be temptation, even if we say we will award it to the current licensees and we'll say to them, continue taking your license, extend it to online gambling. They wouldn't be tempted to move from land-based and focus on the online because it will be easier and cheaper as well. So we need to find that way that will actually create the balance. Like we said initially, our gambling regulation focuses on balancing between the social aspects and the economic benefits. So it shouldn't only create people, rich people, and make others poor. We need to try to ensure the coexistence of that. And I think I have answered this one regarding online gambling, which will also address the question by Mr. Sendri Badayaji. about the same thing. There is another question that the same person indicated about EBTs, why we took so long from 2005 until now, we have not made a decision. You will remember that, and I have answered also on the chat system, but my response, I will repeat again, that the issue of EBTs, we always had a dispute on whether it is actually an advancement of the game of bingo, and that view actually still prevails, because we even had a court judgment that ruled that EBTs are actually slot machines and not necessarily the advancement of the game of bingo. And we were very cautious when regulating gambling that we cannot allow slot machines outside of casinos. And the court judgment actually said the EBTs are just nothing but slot machines, which were not supposed to be allowed outside of casinos. And that is exactly the reason why we have maintained that stand. And that stance was maintained. We had a lot of back and forth with provinces where we wrote letters, we held meetings, until recently when we amended the Gambling Act that we gave in, but we said, let's create a different model and that will address the issue of how many machines we need to allow in the country, how many per licensee and other things. And those were the aspects that were not considered initially when EBTs were first rolled out. Hence, I indicated earlier on that the lessons that we need to draw from there is that we shouldn't have a policy that actually comes from nowhere. It must be something that we have considered and deliberated on in a very thorough way, because we don't want unintended results that might actually undermine our gambling philosophical regulatory mandate that we have adopted from the beginning. And that is exactly why it has taken us that long. We actually disagreed that we should actually be rolling out EBTs in the manner that they have been rolled out. And we are giving in now, and in the bill we have addressed that. Unfortunately, the bill is delayed, and as a result, we are not able to move any further on that one. And I will also touch that it is also the responsibility of the Department of Trade and Industry, Industry and Competition, to deal with the issues of limited payout machines on how to increase the limits and maximum bets allowed for that sector as well. And I think that one, we will actually take it forward, engaging with the National Gambling Board and see how we can address that issue, because indeed it has been a while that those limits were set. But this is not a decision that rests on my shoulders. It has to be deliberated and discussed with all the powers that be. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mashamaite, for the straight to the point, and that has actually assisted in answering a lot of questions. And Mr. Mashamaite has already explained to say, unfortunately, policy does not go with only one consideration, because we've got a lot of stakeholders, we've got a lot of participating elements within our industry. So all those matters need to be taken into consideration. And one of the most important role that the regulatory with the government play is to ensure the well-being of our citizens. And that is the cornerstone of why we exist as a country. So on that note, we have come to the end of our questions, because I think we have answered the majority of those. And please note that some of the questions which are sitting on the queue will be answered by the relevant party. And those which are policy related, I think Mr. Mashamaite has actually gave us a clear and precise snapshot in terms of where we are and what is next, and what are the boundaries that exist at this particular point in time. So on that note, I would like just to go back to my panelists and give each and every one of them at least 2 minutes to just close, give us their closing remarks. And I'll go in the following order. Mr. Winile Gobo, you will be first just to give your closing remarks. I'm giving you 2 minutes to do that. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was a very good engagement, which I believe it is well long overdue in terms of the engagements of the topics around transformative technologies. And our guests who took time to participate. There is an African proverb that I like that says, if you want to go fast, you can go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. So my plea to this is, having worked in a regulatory space, we need to work together to be able to achieve more. We have to engage with our role players and find out how do we go forward on certain aspects of regulation so that we don't leave each other behind and find ourselves to be in conflict with our views. I like this proverb. I apply it to my daily life. Also, having been in the enforcement space, especially where there are criminal activities, you can't do anything on your own. Hence, I believe strongly and have always worked together in collaborative efforts with all the role players, in particular in the illegal gambling space. We have managed to pull together with various law enforcers in the regulation space, that includes South African Police Service, who in the past was aware that there is illegal gambling, but the how and the know-hows and the information around illegal gambling was lacking. We have since managed to establish national and provincial committees who are addressing illegal gambling across South Africa. So these regulators are assisting us now as the national regulator to ensure that within their jurisdiction, illegal activities are addressed. So I'm thankful for the opportunity to engage, and I appreciate all in attendance. And I hope that further engagements, we are not stopping here. We will continue to work together, especially if we want to go far. Thank you.
Thank you, Bawinile. We appreciate your participation and input and the wisdom shared. Next will be a witness. Witness, over to you, closing remarks.
Thank you, moderator. Okay. From a Responsible Gambling Foundation's point of view, we just need to emphasize that winners know where to stop. And unfortunately, when someone has a gambling disorder, it doesn't just affect them alone. It even affects the people surrounding them. And having noticed that online gambling poses a huge possibility for someone to be addicted, we just encourage people to be responsible, to be cautious when you think to indulge on that. Please be cautious, because there are high chances that you might be fraudulently conned, or you might end up being an addict. And as SRGF, we just need to encourage you to be responsible. If in case you notice that you are a problem gambler and are having challenges, we are also there to assist you free of charge. So you just need to get hold of us, then we'll see how we can assist you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, witness, for the wisdom. Ashudu, closing remarks, please.
Thank you, moderator. It was very, very, very insightful for participating in this webinar. And as an employee from the South African Responsible Gambling Foundation, our aim or what we do is to preach responsible gambling to the community and those who are affected or the family members who have been already experiencing these kind of issues in their families, we also offer help to them. And it's very insightful to work with the National Gambling Board. We really appreciate the opportunity, and we hope going forward we will really work together just like this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mashudu. Last, it will be Mr. Shelton Bajua. Mr. Bajua, your closing remarks.
Thank you, Elfias. Thank you, colleagues and stakeholders who have come and spared their time to be with us. My message or my closing remarks are twofold. Our industry is technologically driven and it's very complex. The message that I have for manufacturers, your products are very complex. So my view would be it helps us regulators as well if you could maybe before you even submit your product for testing, maybe run it by the regulator and just make the regulator understand the product so that you won't have a lot of questions later on. If a regulator is not comfortable from the legal perspective, then you can have that discussion before you even go to the test lab, because the test lab will be only looking at the technical aspect of your product. So that's one aspect that I would really want our industry to think and consider and see if we can do that. The other aspect is participation in the standards development. I would really encourage all stakeholders who are interested in our industry in terms of technology, who have the mandate to attend these standard setting committees, to really participate so that we are all on the same page in terms of how we move forward and how we use technology in our industry. I think that's all. Thank you very much. Who has to really participate how we use technology in our industry? I think that's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Pajiwa, for all the wisdom shared and all the answers to the technology aspect that has been posed, which you have assisted, I think, a lot of the industry player being able to obviously apply the strategy which will assist humanity to get through this trying time. And I'm sure everybody appreciates that the technology is not only what is made in terms of electronics, but technology is also evolved with time. When they are saying a technological, they imply that you are always better than you were yesterday. So that is the message which has been coming across to say, yes, of course, we've got the industry that we need to support. We've got an industry that we need to build. We've got an industry that we need to keep on moving. And the technology is there to assist us. But while we are busy doing that, we need to also consider various aspects in terms of that will impact our people, which is both the working class and the sidelined economically and so forth. And while we are busy doing the very same process in trying to mold and build policy, we need to be cautious at the same time that there are those who are weaker than others in terms of falling into such things as a problem gambling, and that also remains the responsibility of our government, including ourselves, to make sure that we assist those who are weaker, who cannot be able to actually carry themselves during those trying time when they are actually affected by problem gambling and so forth. And while we are still on that note, we need to also appreciate that it is through the classification of the licensee, which is called manufacturers, where actually all these products coming from. And then it is through them where we know the industry can evolve through the products that they are giving us. And then we also anticipate that there might be obviously some challenges in terms of regulatory, where we don't have a clear policy framework in terms of where we classify all this product. But it is through this collaboration as an industry, as all players, to say we need to obviously take time and be able to consider all these factors and be able at the same time to engage, because it is through dialogue that we can be able to address all problems and can be able to move forward as a country. Yes, there and there will have challenges in terms of my view, I think it's better than yours, but as a people of South Africa, that should not necessarily be something that hampers us, because we always been known to thrive under difficult times, and then we are even better when we are working together. Thank you very much to everyone, the National Gambling Board, the Provincial Legislative Authority, for obviously participating, the DTCI, manufacturers, operators, and all stakeholders, bookmakers, I'm calling you, bingo operators, site owners who have logged in, and everybody who will be watching this video online after the streaming is done. On that note, I would like to introduce something that Proudly SA has actually prepared for us. For those who are not familiar or who don't know the brand called Proudly South Africa, what it implies is that we need to consume South African services, we need to consume South African products. And what are those products? Those are the products that are created by South African, and they are proudly South African. That simply means all the revenue generated with those products which are produced actually benefit and means in the country. It doesn't get sent through to offshores. The theme to this video that will play very shortly, it goes as follows. During the month of July, at the height of lockdown, Proudly South Africa shot the commercial, and it is called All Coronavirus Protocols Observed. This advert is featuring our very own Dr. Kani, who will be a voice of the President of the Republic, the Honorable Cyril Ramaphosa. And the conscious of the nation, there is a very strong call that we need to all buy what is South African, and a very emotive message, which I hope will resonate with all of you. On that goal, on that note, it is game time, Zansi. I thank you.
The second half is about to begin. We need to change the scoreboard. It's time for all of us to pause and rethink the game plan in order to save the future. I call on all of us to be game changers, because greatness isn't reserved only for some people. By buying local, we're choosing to create jobs and sustain the ones we have. Time and time again, South Africans have taken destiny into their own hands, creating products that the rest of the world wanted to buy. See, the world remembers about us what we sometimes forget, but it's time for change. Let's all buy local.
It's game time, Zansi.
Local is lekker.
Your everyday decisions shape our future.
Can you hear me? Thank you, Alpheus, and the panel for that very enjoyable and interesting discussion. At this point, it's my privilege to wrap up the conversation for the last hour or so. I think we've had quite a journey in terms of what we've had, where we started from, and even though it was a short period of time, I think we learned quite a bit. I think at the start, I mentioned that with opportunities come certain risks, and this is a space in terms of the pandemic and the so-called old versus new normal conversation that when we talk of technology, there may be that fear of change being a negative change. And it's a, you know, that how do we deal with change? But I think the message that comes through from the discussion is that with that change, in terms of transformative technology, we are not looking at it being necessarily something that would harm the industry or would take the industry in a new direction at the expense of something else. Rather, the discussion on transformative technology creates new opportunities. For example, if we just listen to the ad that just played and the message from Proudly South African, that if we now look at developing games and machines locally, we are creating, there's an opportunity for creating jobs. And that is something that perhaps hasn't been properly explored, and we should look into that. So that is the type of conversation the National Gambling Board is trying to have with us as the co-owners of the industry, in a sense. At this stage, I would like to thank various people for making this event a success. Let me start with our leadership, Ms. Caroline Conwell, the Accounting Authority of the National Gambling Board, who has provided sterling leadership to the NGB and giving us the opportunity to have these conversations with the industry. I'd like to thank Proudly South African for the support in enabling us to host this event. And I think it ties very nicely into our theme and how we want to start to develop local capacity and promote job creation and support our economy, but in a South African context and not needing to import everything from offshore. I'd like to thank the colleagues from the Department of Trade and Industry, Mr. Nkwatsi Mashimaite, who spoke to us from the gambling law and policy position, but also to thank the colleagues from the communication and marketing unit of the Department of Trade, Industry and Competition for their support in enabling us to get the message of this webinar out so that the rest of you who are watching were able to join us and participate. And to the rest of the industry who have joined and are watching, it's a big thank you from the NGB as always. I think some of us may remember when the pandemic started and the lockdown hit, and all the different components had to be shut down. My recollection is that the pandemic actually brought us together. I think we started to close ranks and start to look at supporting each other rather than looking at our differences in viewpoints. And I'd like to believe that spirit has not been lost as we are slowly moving into relaxation of these lockdowns. I think that type of the journey we have together ahead of us in terms of transformative technology can only be a success if we are approaching each other in a supportive and collaborative way. So on that note, I thank everyone that participated, all the people viewing from Zoom, Facebook, YouTube, or wherever you are. Thank you for supporting us, and please join us again when we communicate our next webinar. Thank you and have a blessed weekend. Bye-bye.